Hello and welcome to section four of chapter two on personality for AP Psychology. We're looking at environmental influences to personality today. So how much your environment and your surroundings affect your personality? We learned in the last video that, you know, personality is about 0.5 irritable, which is, makes it highly irritable, which means the other half or the other 0.5 is due to the environment. So there's situations in social learning. People act differently based on situation. You probably act differently at school or work than you do in class, and you probably actually change your personality based on your class, the different teachers, different peers, different friends that are in there. Maybe you're a different person when you go to sports versus when you're in band. And so we can modify and adapt things. And so some people would argue that our central traits are the same no matter what. Other people say that our personalities are more malleable, that we can change based on situations. Behaviors are rewarded and punished differently in certain environments. For instance, if you go to McDonald's today and order a Big Mac, and they, you know, they don't give you the right amount, they give you only one slice of cheese or two slices of cheese, are you allowed to yell at them and scream at them and say, "You're terrible! You're awful at your job!" Maybe you would, but that makes you a jerk. But what if you did the same thing at a sporting event? Could you do the same thing to a referee, to an umpire because they blew a call? Is it normal? Is it to yell and scream and tell someone they're terrible, to open your eyes and go home, and you're the worst ref ever? That's more acceptable than yelling at a bank teller or the clerk at City Market or the worker at McDonald's. And so yelling at sporting events is an adaptation of our behaviors and our personalities based on the environment. It's okay to scream at officials sometimes. They're human too. But it's more accepted. You might do some crazy things at a sporting event or a concert than you would normally not do if you were, say, I don't know, at the dentist in the waiting room. Behaviors think personality is a waste of time. It's all rewards and punishments. It doesn't really matter. We all adapt to the environment, to what we can get out of it. So it's just situational behavior patterns of what a personality is to a behaviorist. And so, you know, there's certain ways that you behave at a wedding versus a funeral. The picture here is from the movie Wedding Crashers, in which Will Ferrell's crashing funerals to pick up women, which is just wrong and abhorrent, and we don't agree with. But in the movie, you know, he's getting what he wants, let's say. Then came Albert Bandura, who studied social cognitive learning theory. Who looked at all the factors. Basically, there's society, there's the rewards and the punishments, our culture, and then there's also what's going on in our mind, our cognitive, our thought process and our mental sets. And so he thought that a personality is based on our learning history and our resulting expectations and beliefs, which we'll go into this a little bit more. And so it's based on, you know, what happened in your past, your reinforcers, your experience, and then also your expectations for the next time that something happened. For instance, I don't like getting shots. I'm a big guy. I'm a very large man, if you didn't know, ever seen me in person. But as a child, I had a lot of ear problems. I had to go have surgery when I was five. They had four doctors, and my mother held me down trying to draw my blood. To this day, I'm a grown man. My expectations, I still get nervous. I still look away. I don't watch. I wince in pain, and it doesn't even hurt. But I'm just, because of that, because of my past experiences and because of my expectations, I'm still a 42-year-old man who can't watch a needle go in my arm. And so social cognitive learning theory is a theory that of the continual interaction between your qualities and the situation you're in. So your personality and the situation you're in go back and forth, and they change your viewpoint. There's societal, there's culture, how we should behave, there's the reinforcers, and then also my own perception of it. And so there's reciprocal mutual determination, which is the two-way interaction between yourself and the situation. So for instance, kids growing up in the same house, we have kind of the same environment. You know, you and your siblings, for instance, but they have very different personalities that come from their own experiences. And so they call that, and it's very important to psychologists, the non-shared environment. So here's a picture of my brother and I. I was a sophomore. He was a 7th grader here, yes. And so we went to Chicago, and we have two different perspectives. This is our, you know, we shared a lot of things growing up, but then when we went to class, I went to my sophomore high school classes, and he was in middle school, and he had his group and his teachers, and I had my own, and he did his sports and his activities, and I did my own. That shaped us in different ways to where now in adulthood, my brother and I, yes, we have the same parents. We have pretty much the same DNA, We had the same childhood pretty much, but those non-shared environments made us different people. That coupled with our, you know, different DNAs that we got. So all experience works as reciprocally with our own interpretation of them. For myself, I love my childhood. My brother, his childhood was not as good in his mind. We both went through a divorce. Our parents got divorced when we were young. I was 10, he was 7. It affected him much, much more as a 7-year-old because, you know, he was at a different point. And so we have different views of the same things. And so how we look back at it reciprocates our behavior and our view on life. And those can adapt and change all through the course of your life. You're never set in stone. And so the Columbine High School example, after the tragic shooting in 1999, people wanted to blame everything. It seemed to confirm that the child-rearing techniques influenced personality. So they went after music, they went after movies, and they most importantly, they went after the parents and said, you know what, the parents didn't do their job. How could this happen? They failed as parents. They didn't do what they were supposed to. And what they found was the shared environment of the home has little, if any, influence on personality. You kind of are the way you are based on DNA and based on the non-shared environment. Adopted kids have very similar personalities to their adopted parents. They should, but they don't. Their personalities match their biological parents. And so it's showing that it's more based on DNA. Even though it's heritable at a 0.5 rate, it seems like they kind of tend to be more like their biological parents. Few parents have a single child rearing style that's consistent. Each kid's different, so you have to parent differently. My children in this picture here claim the youngest, Kensington, is the favorite. Well, she's not. She just gets in less trouble because she doesn't have as standoffish personality as my other two. She's maybe not as stubborn. And so it seems like she's favorited, but she just doesn't get as much trouble as the other two because they're basically little versions of me. They're little hard-headed kids who have strong personalities. Most adjuster methods into the temperament of the child. Also, you know, first kids, we're learning with you. We've never been parents before. And so we make mistakes and then we try to correct them for the next kid. And we make mistakes on that one. And by the last kid, or if you have like 8 of them, maybe you've kind of figured it out, or maybe you're just tired and you let them do your own thing and you just can't do it anymore. So even when parenting is consistent, there's very little relation between what they do and how children turn out. Children's kind of a wild card. So even a parent exactly the same for every kid, each kid turns out differently. Parents can influence some highly irritable traits and influence other aspects of their child, you know, like value of education, things like that. Once kids leave home for school, the parents' influence begins to wane. And what grows is their peers and their teachers have a large influence on who they are. And this is a picture of myself in eighth grade with my favorite teacher, Mr. Ellis. And he was the one that kind of inspired me to be a teacher. That wasn't really pushed by my parents, but I identified with that teacher so much that was the career path I wanted to do. And so they actually have found out that the peers have more influence on kids, and you probably know this, than the parents. Most of the 275 freshmen at Cornell, which is an Ivy League school, this study, and this was pre-smartphones, pre-these things, had secret lives or private selves. Their parents did not know. These are the top kids. These aren't kids, you know, dropping out. These are Ivy League kids. Children know the rules at home versus with their peers. They can get away with something. I'm sure you started cussing and saying naughty words and doing bad things much earlier around your friends than you did around your parents. I was a fourth grader thinking I was, you know, a little going to be a rap star trying to do some hip hop stuff, and never said that around my parents though. When did you first curse in front of your parents and it was okay? Maybe much later. Maybe it's still not okay. So peer groups have a lot. And so parents value grades. All parents, not all, but most parents want their kids to do well. In that, they push their kids and they pressure their kids, but that isn't as powerful as their peers. Being cool or fitting in is very powerful for teenagers, for adolescents. And so if the peer group values education, the kid is more likely to do the work. And so study of peer groups and the effects of grades. What they looked at was African-Americans who had African-American friends had very few high-achieving students because there wasn't the same value of education. You could argue, you could flip that around and say sociocultural, that the socioeconomic background, you know, prevents them from having the advantage of other kids. And there's the notion of white privilege, don't get me wrong. But
they also did a correlation that the African-American students who had white friends achieved higher. And so this is that reciprocal determinism that kind of states that we choose our peer groups. And so it's interesting. This is my group here that I grew up with since fourth grade, and most of us lived in an apple tree in a trailer park. And of this group here, two of the six graduated college. This is my basketball team. Now this group, I'm just going to tell you this, we were kind of knuckleheads. We used to punch each other if you said a word over five syllables because you were too smart. So if I said that's unconstitutional, my friends would punch me, and they were very strong. You know, Jeff Austin here was a weightlifter, and he could, you know, squat like 600 pounds. I'm not making that up. So it hurt. In high school, I was still friends with these guys, but I hung out more with my basketball team. And my basketball team valued education. So after my sophomore year, when I was really spending more time with the basketball peers, my grades got better. I did better as an individual. And so my last 2 years in high school, I did the best I did in terms of grades and achievement. And of these peers, every single one of them, with the exception of maybe number three here, I don't know, I haven't confirmed it yet, but they have all are college graduates. I would be willing to bet that number three here, Mr. Heinlein, he also graduated, which is remarkable. There were seven of us, and I'm pretty sure all of us graduated college. And so we valued education at a time in the 90s when that didn't really happen. And so for me, that transition to be around peers that valued education helped me propel myself into college and do much better. I still like these guys. They're still my friends. They're hardworking, great people. There's nothing wrong with it. But the value of education was more supported with my basketball peers. And so I want you to think about, do you hang out with the same friends as a freshman as you did as a senior? And chances are, maybe it's changed. Maybe you got into different things. Maybe people moved. But who you hang out with really helps shape and mold how well you do. And your parents are right. You know, if you lay down with dogs, you're going to wake up with fleas. So I hope you enjoyed this. If you have any questions, let me know. Otherwise, thanks for tuning in.